Stream is running. Welcome to another stream, this time in English. I hope my English is not too rusty and you can and I can conduct my thoughts well. Today we are going to play another league with Legacy Burn, a pretty stock list, also mostly known as kind of quad laser burn because we play a lot of four offs. Compared to last week, I made a couple of changes, rather small ones. I cut the one-off Skewer the Critics for a Rolling Vortex, mainly because now we have a little bit more space in the sideboard, and the Skewer also wasn't really performing well because you have to sequence your spells in a certain order in order to trigger Spectacle, and so I was not quite happy with that. In the sideboard I also made some small adjustments. I cut the Red Elemental Blasts, the two of them, because as Armin also pointed out out in his Legacy stream on the channel from Der Kartenladen, it is not quite as good against Uru as it is against Oko, and therefore, the main purpose of the card in the sideboard is no longer there, and I replaced it with two copies of Searing Blood, which is mainly an adjustment to the rising share of Death and Taxes and Elf decks I've noticed over the last couple of leagues I played, so I will try how that works out. If anyone is already in the chat, please let me know if the sound is fine. It should be, as I didn't make any changes compared to last to the last stream, but OBS updates always can turn that around. So let's start with the match and look for an opponent to test our slightly tuned list. And already three people watching, nice, welcome, welcome. I'm also very interested if someone from the Burn Discord came over, and that's also the reason why I'm trying the stream in English today, so you guys can also understand what I'm talking about. Okay, let's see what we meet. The last couple of leagues I've played, resulted in very mixed results, so to speak. A lot of 2-3s, lots of 3-2s, so, more or less 50%, but a lot of hard matchups, so I'm not too convinced that the position of Burn in the metagame is quite stellar at the moment. This hand on the other side is quite stellar, one drop into someplace on turn 2, Fire Blast also always means that your hand has a lot of more explosive potential, so let's see how this works out. UC could mean a lot of things. Turn 1 Swift Spear. Seems like they are F6ing, which might indicate something, but mostly doesn't. Manipulate Fate, that means we are up against some kind of Food Chain deck, most likely. Exiling the Mist Hollow Griffin. Okay. So I guess we are just trying to be mana effective. I don't think they run too many dazes. I've seen a couple of lists with like one or two of dazes, but if your plan is to resolve a food chain, daze isn't quite the place I want to you want to be, I guess. So I'm not playing around daze too much, I guess. But in this case, with the Rift Bolt, we are daze proof anyways. So now we have a decision to make whether to hit the them down to 10 or the Baleful Strix. In this case, I think it's pretty clear because if he targets the Strix and play another spell, the Swift Spear also represents 3 damage and therefore is it's better to keep the Swiss sphere around and deal with three damage that way, compared to going for the face and trading with the Strix. Force of Will is quite an unusual play, I would say. Well, at least I was not expecting them to force it, but of course it is very dependent on their game plan and their hand, which we don't know. Again, targeting the Strix because the Swiss Sphere is doing the damage. I was contemplating whether I want to go Firecraft for the face, which might actually be a good play as well. And maybe then trade with the Strix, because Firecraft would mean that next turn we have Chain Lightning and Fire Blast, which are 7 additional damage, adding to the 4, we are at 11 already. So drawing a cheap burn spell, especially a 2-mana burn spell, means we would have gotten a kill. We won't, or we might not get that way, but let's see how it works out. Nine people already, thanks for watching, and I would also like anyone to post in chat if the stream is working alright, if sound is good and so on. Not gotten any feedback on that yet. Down to 8, which means we might have lethal next turn, if we get another turn, which is also always, of course, the question, playing against a combo deck, but I guess right now they don't have the starter to get the combo online quite now. Walking Ballista is totally fine with me. Now we have the kill if they don't have exactly force of negation right now, because they're going down to 4 already, and now we attack with the Swift Spear, they trade with the Walking Ballista, or not trade, but sacrifice. Yeah, thanks for the feedback, sounds great. Always happy to hear that. So now they trade with the Ballista, or not trade, as I said, but jump. And now we can go for it, which probably would work out because they have to have exactly Force of Negation and blue card. And we also have a follow-up, which I think is enough, and if they have it, they are on one with no cards in hand, which is fine too. So there's really no merit in waiting for their upkeep, because they have to have Force of Negation anyway, and then they can play it without pitching a card and maybe can get out of the situation. So Food Chain is probably a deck playing Uro. I haven't played against Food Chain since forever, it seems like, but Surgical Extraction seems like a no-brainer, and I guess we are also bringing in the last couple of Vortexes. Food Chain always has been a deck which can rely pretty heavy on basics in my experience, which as I told is quite long ago, but I guess we can cut the price of progresses then, and we have one final cut to make. I guess maybe Lava Spike. Lava Spike is always a contender for cutting because it's, I think, on face value the worst card in the deck. Might also see cutting one of Riftbolt because it is a little slower in the top deck department. Exfil Firecraft is fine because they don't kill us that quickly with their combo, and I Firecraft is always a good option to finish them off. So let's see how game two goes. Interesting hand. I like to keep one land with burn in general, and I think I'm going to keep it as well, since with the second land this hand works out pretty well, especially if they rely on creature removal. We have, if we added up like 16 points of burn already, Endered and Roiling Vortex against a potential Uro. We're also on the draw, which means we get two shots at drawing a land, which means I think all in all I'm going to keep this hand. And let's see how it works out. Yeah, that's of course a little bit lucky to get the land right away. And now we are off to the races. I think we are going to, well, I'm not quite sure yet whether we want to slam the Vortex on turn 2 right away. Which of course gives us some kind of safety for our next spells because of the secret text on Roiling Vortex, meaning that if our opponents cast a spell without paying their mana cost, Roiling Vortex deals 5 damage to them, which is also one of the best things about Roiling Vortex in my experience, because a lot of people don't know that yet. Over the last week I've won several games just because my opponents didn't know how Roiling Vortex works. And the disadvantage to playing Roiling Vortex right now is that if he casts all Rift Bolt later via Suspend, the Rift Bolt will deal 5 to us because we are not paying mana to cast it. But I think between having other options and maybe hard casting Rift Bolt and our life total not mattering too much, I guess, especially if the Roiling Vortex is getting countered, playing the Vortex here is a fine line to take. So now we are still having 13 points of burn. Our opponent used one of their counter spells. We are not getting Uro'd right away. Seems pretty like a pretty okay spot to be in. I'm not excited about it because an Uro from the top or from their hand can end our plans quite swiftly. But apart from that, we have 10 points of burn. They don't seem to have another counterspell, as they have 6 last turn, which again might or might not be an indicator for that. And now we are faced with another decision whether we want to go for it or not. I think I'm playing the Firecraft here and not quite pulling the trigger on the Fire Blast yet, because if they have a counter spell it can turn out pretty badly, and we are also not too close to kill them at 4 life. For example, if they cast a Nuro now, I think I will cast Fire Blast in response. And maybe also if they cantrip now, because I don't want to give them too many extra looks. I'm a little bit worried about the pause at the end step, which again might be checking emails or something like that, but also might be an indicator for them thinking about whether to play an instant speed cantrip like Brainstorm or leaving up mana. But on the other hand, they had two blue mana open anyway, so I guess this is, if there's is it, that's an indication it's for Force of Negation or like old school counterspell. But well, don't know too much about that. I think I'm running out the Chain Lightning right now. There is some merit to keeping spells like that and amass them and all fire them off in a single turn. But I think those kinds of decks might bring something like Flusterstorm or Spell Pierce from the sideboard, or might even have it in the main deck, so not too much of a fan of stacking up too much there. And I'm a little surprised that they let the Chain Lightning resolve, because they already saw Exquisite Firecraft, and if they want to counter a spell, forget what I just said. My thinking was that if they are worried about Exquisite Firecraft, they probably should have countered it, but they were on 4 life anyway, so I guess it makes sense not to counter the Chain Lightning. So Food Chain, for those of you who don't know, is an enchantment that says exile creature you control at X mana of any one color, where X is 1 plus the exile creature's mana cost. Spend this mana only to cast creature spells. So I think I'm fine with that resolving, and if they sacrifice their creatures and using the mana, I might fire off the Fire Blast. Or I might just fire up the Fire Blast right away. I don't see too much difference between those lines. Is there? Well, I guess there's there could be some kind of creature they flash in. Well, I think I just go for it. We are also at 2 mountains left after the Fire Blast, which makes me much more trigger happy on the Fire Blast, and as it turns out, our opponent never had a counter spell in hand, and we easily won that round. I think it was also due to some suboptimal draws from our opponent, because in my experience, this matchup is not that one-sided or easy as it may have looked during this first match. So if you have any questions or comments on my plays, why I took a certain line, or other suggestions, other questions regarding Burn in general, feel free to post them in the chat, and I'll happily answer what I think about the situation. Let's see who our round 2 opponent is going to be. As I pointed out, I've seen a lot of Death and Taxes, of course lots of Euro piles in different way, shapes and forms. I'm not too happy with too many Roiling Vortexes in the main at the moment, mainly because Ragdelver is also a pretty big contender at the moment, and I would I much rather have the Exquisite Firecrafts in the main for this matchups, and also for some other matchups like Miracles or so, where having uncounterable finishers is very valuable. And hi, agent. Where was I? Yeah, I really like the Exquisite Firecraft as an uncounterable finisher, and also the fact that I see a lot of Teferi Time Raveler at the moment bouncing my Roiling Vortexes also diminishes the return of this card. The end step Brainstorm showed it pretty good. What are you referring to which situation? Don't remember the exact play you're referring to. I'm keeping this hand. Of course, it needs lands, but apart from that, it has a lot of gas. Snow-covered mountain could be also a couple of things. Mainly, I guess Moonstompy at the moment, which we have the lightning bolt for a potential Rebel Master or Legion Warboss or the like. Chalice of the Void gets us pretty good, I would say. Oh, Painter Servant also, of course, a possibility. And we are going to snipe that immediately. Again, there's not much difference between hitting face and hitting the creature if we have a Swift Spear in play, which otherwise wouldn't have connected. And you also have to be wary of the combos and the combo potential between, like, let's say, a Soul Land and Lotus Petal. Painter can be also quite a fast combo deck. I think the Painter matchup in general is pretty okay. Okay, this is of course... a little unfortunate. So what are we going to do? I think I'm suspending the Rift Bolt just to have another removal spell for a Painter or maybe even for the Daredevil. And if Rift Bolt is a pretty clunky card at getting that out of my hand right now and having the quote-unquote faster cards during the next turns when we might have our second land. Hi, Marcel or Frederick or whoever is on the account right now. Nice to see you in chat. And now we are also confronted with another decision. I think right now, especially on one land, we have to go for a creature, but hang on for a second, like, what is if, I think we have to draw lands anyway, otherwise we are in big trouble, and they are clocking us for 4 a turn, which is right now 5 more turns. Well, I guess I'm happy going face and trying to be faster. Now the question is whether we want to keep up mana for a potential Painter Servant on their side. If we want to do that, I guess the play would be to just Lava Spike them and keep up the Lightning Bolt. Other lines include either playing Eidolon, which I think is fine if they don't have the immediate land and Painter Servant. And in this, we could also go for Swift Spear Lava Spike them and putting pressure on them that way. I think I'm not playing around land Painter Servant at the moment. So they're at 14. I guess what we could do is Lava Spike them, leave up Lightning Bolt. If they don't hit us with the combo, Lightning Bolt them down to 8, and then if you get a land from top, we have the kill 2 rounds later, but this seems so slow. But I'm not sure whether we are going to be faster anyway, so I think that's the line I'm going to take. It's also the safer line to play around a Painter Servant right now. And the Eidolon also would hurt us in the process quite significantly as well. Snaring Bridge, huh? Okay, I'm totally fine with that. Especially if they give up their City of Traitors for that. Which now makes me much more happy to just go for the face. And I guess we can also play the Eidolon, which would be... which would be lethal in other like situations, for example, if they have a couple of Lotus Petals and Painter Servant or something like that. I'm Yeah, I think there's not too much problem with going down to 12, or rather down to 10. So I guess we could have played the Swift Spear there as well, but I think we are fine anyway. Because I don't think they have any kind of interaction, gaining life or hitting us for six, something like that. Yeah, so that worked out pretty fine. I'm also very happy to win the pre-boarded games because post-boarded is getting much better with all the Smash the Smithereens. I think rolling Vortex doesn't do too much for us here. Because they are not playing too much spells where they don't use mana for it. Lotus Petal is the one that comes to mind, but they play that out early anyway. And the one damage per turn and life gain is also not a big factor. I think Rolling Vortex doesn't do too much. I'm not too sure on Price of Progress as well because they play, of course, they are a monocolor deck, but they also play Ancient Tomb, City of Traitors, and what's it called? Great Furnace or something? No, the Red Artifact land. And I think I'm happy cutting Price of Progress here because it mostly would deal, I guess, 2 damage. Sometimes 4, and all the other spells are cheap and effective, and also point mostly at creatures, which is a fine thing if you want to stop the combo early. Yeah, and this hand is exactly what we're looking for. We have the Fire Blast as late game or late game regarding to burn as finisher. I think that's a better way to say it. We have the Smash the Smithereens for a combo. We have the Chain Lightning for a Painter's Servant. And, well, I guess I hope that we don't get comboed on turn 2. Apart from that, I'm feeling pretty fine at this spot at the moment. And to combo us on turn 2, they need quite a lot of things to go right. Well, Wet Elemental Blast, of course. Pyrokinesis, huh? Well, I'm happy then that I didn't play out things earlier. Trinisphere, okay. Now I'm starting to get a little bit worried because we need to draw enough lands, which of course, we did just like a professional. And they don't have a land. So I'm not quite interested, I think, in blowing up the Trinisphere or the Grindstone quite yet because it seems like it's hurting them as well. Let's see, if they want to combo, they can play another land, then play the Painter's Servant, and then, of course, we also want to blow up the Painter's Servant and not the Trinisphere. So I think we are happy playing the Eidolon, which puts a lot of pressure on them since they use the Ancient Tomb for their cards as well, and the triggers of the Eidolon add up as well. So round 2 went pretty smooth as well. I think the Trinisphere finally hurt them much more than it did harm us. So 2-0-2-0, pretty stoked about the start because, as I stated earlier, I think Burn is kind of a, at best, 50-50 deck at the moment, where I'm happy with every 3-2 I can get, and starting 2-0 seems like a good start to me. also 8 people watching already. Nice to have you all around at the weekend. And some new nicknames, at least some I don't recognize. Are you from the Burn Discord by any chance? I would like to know if you enjoy it and if I should continue doing stuff like that, because streaming in English is new to me, and yeah, if everyone in the chat understands German, I would also stream German, of course. Okay, I'm just rambling, and we are playing against Mats Ole, which is that nickname kind of rings a bell, but I'm not too sure to connect it with the archetype or deck. I guess this hand is fine. We can get the Rift Walls out of the way. We have a lot of potential if we draw off our second land, which we have been quite good so far at during this league. Which is also a very big factor with Burn at the moment. It seems like, well, it's a factor with Burn in general, but if you don't hit your top decks, be it lands or be it Burn spells, in the right situations, you can have a really rough time. And so far this league, Lady Luck is on our side, so let's see if that continues. Putrid Imp, so we're playing against some kind of Hogak, Dredge, or something kind of that. I guess there is not much we can do altogether against those kinds of decks at the moment, apart from trying to be faster, which is also pretty hard with this hand because we don't have a creature or another source of repeatable damage. Well, apart from Roily Vortex, but one damage a turn isn't that much of a repeatable damage source. So I guess I'm just hoping for the best, that is maybe a slow Hogak start or something like that, that we draw our land at time. But we have already 10 points of burn in our hand, 3 in the exile zone in form of the Rift Bolt. So I think we might get a turn 4 kill if we are lucky and top deck the right things. Basking Rootweller, huh. Spicy. It's been a while since I've seen that card in Legacy. In Vintage, of course, I think it is quite a staple in some of those Survival of the Fittest type decks. And we're getting clocked pretty hard here, so we're soon having to make a decision whether we want to continue to be on the burn in the face plan, because our opponent doesn't seem to have a pretty quick start, which means we could get away with just handling the creatures. But I think right now, especially with Fire Blast, I'm happy enough going face, because I also don't want to give them time. And also, like, Putrid Imp isn't that much of a threat. If they want to put the mana into the Root Waller all the time, I'm fine. And Bloodgast also comes back. So I think we don't hit the creatures quite yet. Do we change our plan after not hitting our second land again? So right now we're taking 6 a turn, and we could cut the clock down to 3 a turn, which of course gives us much more time. But if we chain lightning the Root Waller, we also don't have too much left in the tank, because the question with burn is always in those kinds of spots some kind of resource management. How many resources do I have? And if I have plenty, I'm always or I'm much more likely to burn the creatures, because then I have shut down their clock effectively, and also have a lot of resources left. But if I only have a couple of resources, and I shoot down the creatures, I don't get too much because I also need to draw much more resources. And since these two Price of Progress seem to be pretty dead at the moment, I think we just hope that we get another burn spell in the land or some sort of that and be able to finish them off quickly. Cabal Therapy, of course, pretty bad, which means they probably take away a Lightning Bolt and or Fire Blast, because those are always the most likely things to get named by your opponent. Lightning Bolt, mostly because everyone is associating burn with Lightning Bolt, and the people that know their burn matchup often name Price of not Price of Progress, Fire Blast, because there's such an impactful card to name. Running Board Tanks also would have been nice against Flashback Therapy, but can't have it all, right? 14 people, wow. Much love to all you guys. Thanks for watching, and also feel free to participate via chat, ask me questions, give me some feedback. I'm not too sure how I am going to sideboard, because I have a lot of Graveyard Hate in my sideboard, but I'm not too sure what this deck is all about. Blood Gas, okay, I get that part, but it doesn't seem to be some kind of all-in-ear strategy like Dredge or something like that. It doesn't seem like a Hogak deck to me. Is it just some value Madness Bloodcast pile? Because I think this would change how I approach the sideboarding. So, yeah, I guess we are pretty dead anyway. So, is there any chance we're winning this? We're getting hit for 6 next turn, 6 the turn after, so we are probably dead by then. I guess our best chance is to hope to top deck a Fire Blast and have them play another non-basic land for some reason, and we can Price of Progress them out, but doesn't seem like a very likely thing to happen at the moment. Okay, so they are some kind of Hogak deck. Yeah, that's a good suggestion or a good good comment. There definitely could be some Vengevines. I'm just so confused by the Rootfaller, which seems so unimpactful if you want to go for that kind of strategy. But you're the Hogak expert, I guess, since you play a lot this deck a lot of on stream too. Yeah, so we fire off the Price of Progress and really are still hoping to get the Fire Blast at least, so maybe they play land before before attacking us. I guess we're not lucky. Okay, so I'm definitely boarding out Price of Progress. I'm bringing in all the Graveyard Hate in form of Leyline and Surgical. I guess Roiling Vortex is pretty good against Hogak as well. I think the Firecrafts are pretty clunky. And Snaring Bridge is also a card I have been quite impressed by in general in the meta at the moment, because it's not too much investment to put it as a one-off in your sideboard, and there are so many situations it saves you from, like if it sticks against some kinds of decks, they don't tend to bring an artifact aid. It's pretty good against decks like Eldrazi or Ruck. If it sticks, of course, it's hard to stick against some kind of Ruck deck or so. And saved me a lot of times, and was quite impressed by that. So the question remains, do I want to have more Rolling Vortex? And what would I cut for it? I think I'm not too happy to cut too many more spells, because those, well, on the other hand, I guess I could take out some Rift Bolts. On the other hand, there is those matchups tend to go very long. If it's a situation where I have a Leyline of the Void and they don't have the immediate answer, so having a recurring source of damage is somewhat valuable. And well, let's see. Yeah, this is enough. We have our piece of interaction in form of Surgical Extraction. We have our turn one play in Goblin Guide. We also have a little bit of follow up, but it's in general very little action, and I think that is not enough for me to keep this hand, because of, well, if they are on a kind of slower start, like last time, the Surgical doesn't do too much, because we only get rid of one kind of threat they have. If they have Vengevine, Bloodghast, and Hogak, yeah, I think I'm not too happy with that, but I could be definitely see being wrong. Yeah, that's also a fair point. That Force of Vigor might be an argument against Vortex. But on the other hand, if they have Vigor, they probably play it out early. So this hand simply doesn't do too much, and I have four ley lines to mull to. This is exactly what I'm looking for. A lot of gas and the ley lines, so they have to have the answer and beat our fast draw. I think I'll just keep the Fire Blast, since it's so good if it works. And we have a recurring source of damage. We don't have too many lands. Let's go for that. And they don't have to seem Force of Vigor, which makes me pretty happy, and especially since Force of Vigor isn't their top deck as well. And I'm also not too sure whether they bring in Force of Vigor, or do you bring in Force of Vigor against every matchup, even if you don't know what kind of hate they're going to bring to the table, because in general, I think it's quite unusual for Burn to play Leyland of the Void. They rather play Fairy Macabre or Surgical Extraction, if you want to look at lists, which of course, with a fringe deck like Burn, if you look up lists, that's not a real indication of what people might play. Hogak, okay, you can have that. So Frederick, I'm interested, would you have kept the hand with the Surgical Extraction? Do you think that's enough, or I'm not too sure whether this was the right call, especially since we ended up mulling further. Okay, so they have another Root Waller. Good for them. So they don't pump the Root Waller. I don't think I'll bolt it, and I'm not sure whether I want it anyway. But it seems like they're up to something. Sylvan Safekeeper. Okay. I think I'm quite happy with the race at the moment. We have 7 points of burn in our hand, we are taking them for 4 a turn, and we had a quite comfortable life total. And Once Upon a Time also is a slow card. So, do we want to bolt the Root Waller now or wait if they pump? Because I think that's what they're going to do, so... Yeah, I think I wait whether they pump because they have the safe keeper anyway to give shout to their Root Waller, and then we can decide whether it's worth for it to... make them sacrifice land, which means also that they can't play the Once Upon a Time they have on top, and they can't pump the Root Wallers, which I think is fine here, I guess, because otherwise if we don't do it we get hit, well, we don't get hit for too much, I guess. It's like 4-6 a turn. We get to hit them back for 2. I think I will go for it because it really cripples them in their development. At least I hope so. Really? Are they going to keep back creatures in double block? I think that's fine with me. Of course, having the lightning bolt would also have been quite nice. Blood gas, you can have that. And now we are getting for 2 a turn and only have to hit a couple of more burn spells. And let's see. Yeah, and thanks for your feedback on the mulligan decision. I also think the one extraction wouldn't do the job, and one guide, one bull just isn't too much action. Well, we also might just get beaten to death by Root Wallers, especially if they get pumped. But I think there's no point in bolting them and giving them a lot more time. Well, at some point we might have to, and this point might be right now, I think. Because otherwise we just lose too much life. But now we still have a little bit time to top deck our spells. Maybe we should have bolted the Root Waller earlier, but I was quite confident that if we get some top decks, we could get out of the situation. Also, a creature always would have been a perfect top deck at that point, because they only can pump one of their Root Wallers. Yeah, so I guess we're fire blasting a Root Waller then. But right now I'm not too happy with our spot anymore. Okay. And Snaring Bridge, on the other hand, of course, is pretty good top deck. We have to kill this anyway, and then we hope to not draw another ley line. and hope that they don't find the third root waller. Yeah, I think in hindsight I probably misplayed at some point, because with those resources and how the game went, I guess it shouldn't be that close. Imp is also, of course, a threat that might kill us. So, we are probably losing this match, but we have two more to go. Second imp is quite the challenge, and yeah, we're done here, unfortunately. Drawing Leyline and Sandbridge is kind of a non-bo, as it turns out. I think this matchup, especially with their approach, is quite favorable for Burn. I played against some slower Hogarth, maybe also with Dark Depth, some kind of piles in that direction. I think it's fine because they're not too fast. You have the potential in game one just to race them. And yeah, post board they're sometimes surprised by Leyline, and sometimes they beat you with the scrappy creatures they have. Yeah, the draws didn't work out too well. Two Leylines, six lands, as Marco is pointing out. But well, that's how the cookie crumbles sometimes. We had a very lucky talk to decks in the first two matches. So let's see what's up for the next round. Also, haven't faced an Uro by now, which is like step one of going positive with Burn. Step two is dodging Dark Depth and other fast combo decks. Yeah, this hand is also a hand I'm snap keeping. Turn one Goblin Guide, lots of action, two draw steps to hit our second land. Sometimes you don't and you lose, but in general, I'm more than happy with a hand like that, especially seeing Flooded Strand, which indicates some kind of control deck mostly, but also, of course, just could be Rakdelver Delver since every. Land in their deck is an island, they can play whatever fetches they want. There even like there used to be and probably still are a lot of Rakdelver pilots who feel very sneaky to play Wooded Foothills because it also fetches every land in their deck, and trying to mislead opponents by playing turn one Foothills. That's a very small edge to gain, but an edge nonetheless. So, it looks like our opponent is indeed on some kind of Delver list, either Rak or maybe UR. UR Delver is, I think close matchup, a little in favor of Burn, while Rak Delver is the other way around, but both are pretty close matchups. And here, is appealing to play the Eidolon, which I also might do, even if it runs into the days. The other line would be to play Lava Spike into Rift Bolt, which of course plays around days but doesn't stick an Eidolon. If I only had one Eidolon, I would definitely go for the line of playing Lava Spike and just suspending Rift Bolt. But with two Eidolons in hand and the Eidolon also hurting us very much, there is quite a lot of merit to just running out the Eidolon. If they don't have days, it's of course the best play. Yeah. On the other hand, if it's blue red Delver, the Eidolon is really valuable. And I think I'm in the end going for the conservative play and hope that this line doesn't punish us by some fast creatures by them and us getting tripped up on my own Eidolons. Well, that's working out fine, because now I can play around days. I also don't have to worry about things like Force of Negation, since this is a creature spell. I can leave up my Lightning Bolt and Force of Will. Pitching Force of Will, I'm very happy to see that, especially since I have the second Eidolon. Indeed, it appears to be Rakt Delver, and I hope they're playing a version without Uro. Well, that much regarding this hope. Yeah, Uro is tough to beat in a spot like that, where you like create a couple of resources against Lightning Bolt and Force of Will, and Uro will just run away with the game. Fortunately, right now we still have a little bit of time, since they have to draw two more lands. Also in the right color, which means one more green source, I guess, for them. And they also have to fill up their graveyard a little bit, which means they probably will trigger the Eidolon a couple of couple more times. Uro itself triggers the Eidolon, so I guess we still have a shot, but 14 life is also quite a lot to work through. Okay, yeah, I guess it makes sense that they have Lightning Bolt in hand, because they passed the turn with 2 mana up, so they don't seem to have a cantrip. Tarmogoyf also makes sense. They're probably waiting for the green source. Fifth land is probably the point where of no return, where yeah, we're getting clocked really quickly, and they probably have some sort of interaction or some plan to play Uro in the next couple of turns. So this game is pretty much over, but well, let's see. Let's see how it turns out. Text Drinker, yeah, I'm fine with that. Still seem to miss the next land drop, which is pretty nice. I would love to top deck Price of Porias at some point when the Wasteland is still tapped. Which could mean that the game swings back in our favor at some point. So, are we on the Bolt the Hex Drinker plan? Not yet, definitely, because we want to waste some more mana of our opponent, which they might put into the Hex Drinker, especially if they use the Wasteland. It also means that the Price of Progress is a good draw, but I think we need every bit of resources we can get here. And, well, we're getting hit only by one, which also surprises me, because I think if our opponent would have attacked a little bit more aggressively, we would have a much worse time, because right now we are pretty likely to survive the next turn as well, because even if they get the other Hex Drinker to a 4-4, we are only taking 13. So I'm happy going down to 15, and they might not even attack with everything next turn, because they're afraid of the backswing from this swift sphere. Yeah, still on the hoping to top deck exactly price of progress plan. Well, that's unfortunate. Second Uro is probably lights out. Yeah, this is also the same kind of situation where I would love to have an ensnaring bridge. Okay, so guess I block now, because what that means is that I don't die next turn, and I also have to top deck amazingly, like double Price of Progress or something like that, or Price of Progress and another burn spell at least. So, time for Price of Progress to show up, for them to tap out, and them also don't having a lightning bolt. Many things that have to go right. And they, of course, don't having a force of will or force of negation. Wanted to bolt them end step, but it doesn't make too much of a difference. Well, I can play Swift Spear and hope that they don't attack with everything, which, given that they play very defensively, might as well happen. And, well, let's have a look. But yeah, regarding sideboarding, I'm definitely bringing in my one of Surgical Extraction. I would love also in the meta right now to play more than one, but I don't own more, and it's like a 30 or 40 euro card on Magic Online, I think. Okay, we are done here. So, apart from that, I'm liking the Ensnaring Bridge, since those are a lot of attrition-based matchups where you trade a lot, one for one counterspell, lightning bolt for Goblin Guy, daze for Eidolon, whatever, and having an ensnaring bridge at the top end can really swing the game back in your favor. I'm not liking Rift Bolt too much, because I think the Rakdos decks are back to playing Stifle. And for some reason, most of them still keep Stifle in my experience. I don't know what they're expecting to Stifle, but yeah, I think Searing Blood isn't quite good enough, because it only deals with Delver and not with the other threats, and you can't allow dead cards in your hand mostly. So the question is, do we want to bring in more Roiling Vortex, which are fine, especially on the draw, but yeah, they don't do too much, because first of all, they don't have much sources of constant life gain apart from Uro, and they don't bring back Uro that quickly. And if they bring back Uro, and you have to have Roiling Vortex and the mana up at the moment, it's quite hard to achieve all of that. But I think, yeah, maybe I'm like going up to two of them. On the play, it's something we can allow ourselves also, because the role of who the aggressor and how much you want to trade resources and how much you're going to for the face really changes this matchup, depending of whether you are on the play or the draw. Like if you think about, for example, a card like Eidolon or Roiling Vortex or a 2-drop, then if you're on the play and they daze it, they're on 0 lands, so they maybe played a cantrip beforehand and we have 2 lands and are ready to go and follow our game plan. On the other hand, if it's our turn 2 and we get dazed, it's a much different situation because they also used their mana beforehand and we are suddenly much more behind. If they, for example, play a Tarmogoyf and then daze our turn 2 play. And that's why the 2-drops are much better on the play than with the draw, especially in this matchup. So I think I'm not. Well, maybe I am playing the Lightning Bolt into the daze, but I think right now there isn't quite a reason to do that yet. There's some arguments for doing it now because, especially two arguments right here, because we get the 2 extra points of damage, but we get them next turn anyway, or at least maybe, and our hand is very light on spells that require us to tap out, and well, the Exquisite Firecraft requires us to tap out, but by then hopefully we can enable spell mastery. Or at least enable it in response with a Fire Blast, which is always a lot of fun if they think they can counter the Firecraft and then you get them with a surprise Fire Blast, hitting them for four and making your Firecraft uncountable. So, Tarmogoyf. Okay. So we are going to attack and hopefully get them with the double bolt, because even if they counter the bolt, our Swift Spears are going to be a 3-4 and their Goyf is only to go to a 2-3 because of the type instant which comes into the graveyard, and their counters won't change that. And if they don't block, we are getting lots of damage in. Hopefully. Okay. Pretty aggressive on the Force of Negation there. They still go down to 8, I guess. I mean, we could also fire out the Fire Blast, but that would be really aggressive and also wouldn't kill them right away. And we have the Exquisite Firecraft here. The Force of Negation unfortunately means that we only have one Lightning Bolt in our graveyard, and that means that our Firecraft is turned off. Oh, that's bad news. But we have Lethal right now. Between the 8 damage, putting them to 3, and the Swift Spear. Well, that was loose. I think it's much better to play the Firecraft and hope for it to get countered, and then preventing it with the Fire Blast. Well, maybe it is not, because in this case you lose against daze, and by playing the land first, you play around that. So I think it's time to go for it. It saves our Swift Spear and requires another force from them. And if they have it, it's not the end of the world as well, because they even need more lands to get out the Uro again. Yeah. Worked out pretty nicely, this draw. Can't complain too much, and let's see whether we want to change something for game three, and I think I definitely want to trim a little bit on those two drops, get those back in. Because I think Roiling Vortex is just, and Eidolon are just hurting us at least as much as they are hurting them. So I think going something like that might be a good idea. Maybe even getting the extra Eidolon and cutting the Vortex. I'm not too sure if they work, they're really good, but more often than not, they well turn out to be very suboptimal on the draw, especially if they match up against Daze. Well, this hand doesn't do anything. This does. We also got our Eidolon, which I definitely going to keep despite like saying I don't want to have too many of those two drops. You, especially in a matchup like this on the draw, or not on, not especially on the draw, but in a matchup like this after a mulligan, you really want your hand to have potential to do something, and the Eidolon is definitely potential because if it sticks around and gets off two or three triggers, or at least two, and maybe gets an attack in or so, it can really be a big part of our game plan. Because just bolting them over and over between their counters and us mulliganing simply won't do the job. I'm a little afraid that they have some heavy hitters as well, in form of Uro or something like that, because they didn't play one drop, which is very very untypical for this kind of deck, because it mainly consists of one drop. Also, no cantrip, no Delver, no Lightning Bolt. What is this? Tarmogoyfs and Uros and counter spells or something? Okay. So now we are having to make a decision. I think my decision is to bolt the Tarmogoyf. If they don't have a counter spell, it works out nicely. If they want to waste a counter spell on the Tarmogoyf, I'm totally fine with that as well. And we can also get the attack here and see whether they respect the second Lightning Bolt, especially after the last game, and they do. And so we get in some extra points of damage. And I think I'm going to play the Swift Spear here. They didn't daze it the first turn, of which of course could have been just to play turn to Tarmogoyf, but if it gets dazed, is it this way, and now we don't have to be in the awkward spot of having three lands, Eidolon and Swift Spear, and being how do I sequence that? Do I play the Eidolon safely and get the true damage from casting my Swift Spear, which you really don't want to do, and if your opponent already has a Goyf. Yeah, tough spot to be in for sure, and if an Uro shows up, it's pretty bad, but what can you do? On the other hand, yeah, that's what I thought, like, Goyfs and Uros makes much sense, that those are the type of cards our opponent has in hand when not playing a turn one, thing turn one. So, we need some good draws, maybe Price of Progress from the top at a certain moment. They also aren't able to play Uro for quite some time, hopefully. And maybe between Eidolon, Fire Blast, and Lucky Top Decks, we can, like, cheat out a victory somehow. Well, that's rough. Yeah. That's rough. Not more, much more to say about that. So, are we going to Fire Blast in response? I guess we do. because it saves our Swift Spears from dying. It kills the Tarmogoyf. And hopefully they don't have another counter. And we have the next land anyways, so we're not too much impacted by sacrificing our two mountains. Yeah, maybe I should stop talking about it. Well, to be fair, I'm talking about it because I thought that the way they played made it likely that they had Uro. But of course, maybe I'm not too sure which what is correlation and causality at this moment. Yeah, that's what I say. They keep in stifle like four. Right now it works out somehow by killing a Swift Spear, but there are so few times where Stifle actually does anything. Maybe sideboards are constructed in a way right now in the meta that they don't have anything to take out, but there's really no point in leaving in Stifle. Okay, third land, not exactly the draw I was hoping for. But at least if you draw an Ensnaring Bridge or an Exquisite Firecraft right now, yeah, it's like we have to do 13 damage before Uro comes back, which, especially with them drawing the next land, quite unlikely, I might say. Yeah, so 10 down to 8, down to 7. Down to 7 from fetching. Yeah, we need an Insane Bridge or a well-timed Price of Progress, which it wouldn't even do it here because they really, I think, won't have many reasons to tap the Wasteland, especially except for them drawing another Hex Drinker. And even then, they probably shouldn't, but maybe they do. Somehow hope that flips to something like a Daze or something that is not very impactful, because if it doesn't, it means they either draw another big threat or they are getting the fourth land, which... also means trouble, okay. So they didn't show the card? Ah, Hex Drinker. Okay. Well, if I talk about Price of Progress and it shows up, I'm fine with that right now, because it's most definitely lethal right now, and opponent is out of cards. So, one time Price of Progress, please. Yeah, it's close to it. Yeah, that's the point. They could stifle their own Uro trigger. That's also the idea of some other decks, like there's a Dreadnought deck with Uro with the same idea. But it's like they need 4 mana for that, and for Rug Delver to have 4 mana and that be the play, I think that might be the reason that they keep it in. But in my opinion, it's not a it's not worth it, but I'm not a Rug Delver player, so I'm... Oh, come on. Well, maybe they are... well, which level is it? So it needs 5 more counters? So maybe they're just... pumping up the Hex Drinker, and we can get away with it. Firing up the Price of Progress now would deal 5, because they would waste one of their lands and fetch and fail to find, I guess. Which, I could fire it up now, which means that any further burn spell is lethal, but especially with the hex drink, I think the chance that they pump up the hex drinker now is high enough, hopefully. So, let's hope that they, for some reason, don't wasteland two of their lands. Yeah, in hindsight, I think it's. Yeah, I think I misplayed. I think it's much better to. Yeah, and that was just better on my part. I think it's much better to play the Price of Progress. Which means that, well, I'm not too sure on that, but if they top deck a land, in that scenario, they're not playing the Uro. And, well, I think if, well, I guess if I top deck a mountain, it doesn't matter too much anyway. Well, yeah, but I think it's probably the correct play to. Tough spot to be in. Okay, so 2-0 and 2-2-2. Let's play the last match and hope that it all goes well. Also happy that 9 people are still watching. Thanks for your endurance in those like matchups where you as the burn player are a lot of the time in on the under pressure and well. Maybe it's not the most fun to watch sometimes against Uro, but I guess those matches were fine and not that drawn out as some of them tend to be. Okay, this is fine. It's nothing to write home about, but playing Chainlight in turn one, having back-to-back Eidolons, having finishers, it's a lot of power level in the right matchups. It also has the potential to fall pretty flat, but. If there are some kind of deck that gets hoses by Eidolon, great hand. If it's kind of a blue-based control deck without Daze, great hand, because they have probably have to counter the Eidolon and we have pretty much late game potential with our Firecraft. Going down to 16. Is this Elves? Oh no, it's probably some kind of Maverick style deck, which kind of might be a problem for this kind of hand, because we don't get rid of the Birds of Paradise, and if they start playing huge threats like Knight of the Reliquary right away, it could be that our game plan is just too slow, and Eidolon again is a card that might hurt us. Not cracking Verdant Catacomb is a good sign. Yeah, Sylvan Library is a pretty good sign because it means that they don't have an impactful 3 drop. They take 2 damage for some kind of card selection, get hit by the Eidolon, or maybe not. Maybe the reason they played it this way is because they want to have a removal spell for the Eidolon. That might as well be the case. So we attack and see. Wow, okay, so this seems pretty nice. Well, I think there's not much harm in playing the Lava Spike first. I would really be surprised if that somehow is a Daze deck after all, and the other way around, we take 2 unnecessary points of damage. And now I think we are in a pretty good spot because I don't think there are too many 4 drops that punish us heavily here. We have 8 points of burn. Which means that if they fetch and play a CMC 3 or less card, They're dead if they don't gain any life. Well, the 4-drop that could punish us here is Green Sun Zenith, if I think about it. But, well, seems pretty solid. Also, the powers from the opponent signals that it's not an obvious, like, Green Sun Zenith go for a Knight of the Reliquary play, probably. Thoughtseize. Huh. Is this the, I just want to know what's going on, Thoughtseize? Because it seems pretty courageous to go for the Thoughtseize in this spot. Yeah, maybe it's just I want to know what's up, which is a line I can definitely respect, and it's also paid off a little because Exquisite Firecraft is not a given in burn decks. So I'm well not too convinced that Smash with Smithereens is good in this matchups. Or in this matchup, because they don't seem to be a Chalice deck with Birds of Paradise. Some of those decks are some kind of Stompy decks with Mox Diamond and Chalice, and Smash Smithereens is very good against them, but with Birds of Paradise, it doesn't seem like that is the case. Graveyard Hate also, nothing I'm really excited to bring in. Yeah, Roiling Vortex has its pros and cons for sure. There's not much in terms of like free spells I would expect, so and also from what I've seen, not too much life gain potential. Of course, there's always Swords to Plowshares and stuff like that, and well, maybe the occasion Scavenging Ooze, but Roiling Vortex isn't that good against Scavenging Ooze to start with, because the Ooze can be activated multiple times in response as well. I guess Firecraft is very clunky, especially since those decks often played, or maybe not often, but at least sometimes play Thalia or something like that. Well, actually, we are really speculating a lot here because there is a lot of different types of decks, or not types of decks, but builds. We haven't seen a white source, so it also might mean something completely different. It seems to be a creature deck, I guess. But, well, we didn't see any creatures by now, but I guess it has to be some kind of creature deck. So I think Bridge is fine, and I think I'm bringing up Vortex over the Firecraft. But let's see, and maybe find out what our opponent is up to. Yeah. Not good enough, I think. Well, my heuristic in general is to mulligan almost all four-land hands, especially except if you know the matchup and have some heavy hitters, and it simply does too little, especially against a turn one discard spell. You have like 6 points of burn in your hand. This is much better. I kept in price speculating that probably they are not a two-color deck, and that the forest is not representative of a lot of basics they are going to be able to fetch. Searing Blood seems fine against all the mana dogs. Yeah. I think I'm botching Price of Progress here. Not Price of Progress, Rift Pool here. Hi Armin, nice that you managed to tune in. We are 2-2 right now. We won against Food Chain in round 1, won against Painter in round 2, had a close last match against Drug Delver, where the Price of Progress showed up exactly one turn too late, and we also lost against some kind of Hogak deck where we had the ley line turn 2, but weren't able to really get it off the ground, and also mulled to 5, drew 6 lands, and got beaten up by Rootwallers, also a rare sight. Okay, so they fetched Basic and played Bird of Paradise, and now it's an interesting spot because we can bolt the bird, which means on the one hand maybe we screw up their mana because they fetched the Basic and maybe are relying on the Birds of Paradise for their next turn. We could also wait. We could also wait and hope that Seeing Blood hits the birds. But I think I'm inclined here to play Chain Lightning just because, or of course I'm playing Chain Lightning, but I'm inclined to target the bird because otherwise, if they get a turn 3 play, our whole Seeing Blood, the bird thing, and so on doesn't really is very much impactful. And now, if they have to rebuild with another Mana Dog or Dryad Arbor or whatever, we have the potential to blow them up or to blow them out. And I think it's worth it here, even if it m could mean that our next turns don't go too smoothly. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Now we know what they're up to, I guess. It's the famous Cover Predator life gain deck with what is the name of the card? Well, the idea is basically they give Cover Predator, they play Invigorate and all other kinds of nonsense. Yeah, so I guess Seeing Blood could cut down the cutter here. And well, I guess Rolling Vortex is pretty good in this case. Because all those spells are free, and maybe they don't read the Vortex well enough. False Cure, yeah, that's it, exactly what I meant. Why did I bring in Vortex? Well, first of all, we didn't know what he was playing exactly, and that it's False Cure. I thought it was. Well, we got a lot of mixed signals, whether it was some kind of Maverick build or not, and well, yeah, I ended up bringing in Vortex for some, or I think I brought in a split. I'm not too sure. Okay, so what do we do here, in order to maximize our chances? We have one Ensnaring Bridge in our deck, so that could be a plan. Yeah, we're getting hit for 9 turn, which is simply too much, probably. And like Seeing Blood on this the cutter also doesn't accomplish too much. Yeah, but I guess it's. Oh, well, I think it's. Yeah, I think the Vortex is the better play. Well, yeah, it's quite clear that you play the Vortex, but I was an answering questions from chat and thinking about the matchup in general, and that's why I didn't make the play right away. But yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I am definitely boarding out Price of Progress then, because they seem to be a two-color version of the deck, and of course, they won't go for too many non-basics. Reverent Silence, of course, is nice. Yeah. Okay, down to 16. Down. Yeah, it's. And that's game. So they are hitting us for 21 trample damage, and I guess, yeah, that happened. So we bring out the Price of Progress, we get in some kind of firecraft again. Really not many targets for either Smash nor Graveyard Hate, so I guess on the play Seeing Blood can be still fine to deal with Birds of Paradise or the like, but maybe it's also a potential dead card in combo kill scenarios. I'm definitely think that especially on the play I'm much happier with slamming Roiling Vortex on turn 2 and preventing them from all this light, or at least making it painful for them to fulfill their game plan. So what do you think? Is it worth it to bring in Seeing Blood? We only seen Birds of Paradise as a good target. Firecraft was fine. I was very convinced of it against Delver. I think I don't remember whether we cast it against Food Chain, but I think we did, and it felt very good there too. And in those two matchups, I'm definitely happy with it. Of course, against Hogak, well, it was I don't think we drew it there. And what was the fourth matchup? Yeah, against Painter, it also wasn't too much to talk about there. Yeah, I think I'm off Searing Blood. Yeah, Invigorate is also a good point to not play it. Yeah, I think this is just not enough. Yeah, of course you can try to Searing Blood the cover, but it's hard to get the right spot, I think, and to have mana open. This hand seems like it's a very good 3-spell hand as far as 3-hand spells are concerned, but I don't think it cuts it because one removal spell, one discard spell is enough and it falls apart quite quickly. Well, I'm going to keep that hand and let's see how much work Roiling Vortex can do. I'm not too concerned with playing the Riftbolt early because we can half cast it off the three lands and maybe 5 damage doesn't matter too much because they have a large Kavu anyway. Not perfect but keepable, the first hand or the second? Well, I would have loved to have a Seeing Blood, but you know. Yeah. Yeah, rough go. 4 lands is also not ideal, especially if you mulligan. But yeah, maybe we get there, and it's, at least their combo is pretty prohibited from our Roiling Vortex. Okay, that's fine with me. I only have bad cards in my hand anyway. Green Suns going for Dryad Arbor. Yeah, I think I'm agreeing with you in the sense that it is playable, but I think especially with the new mulligan rule, your chances of having a 4-spell hand and also being a 4-spell hand being functional is way higher with the new mulligan rule, especially, and even under the old rule I think I would have mulliganed this hand. Because with the new mulligan rule, in order for you to not have 2 lands 4 spells, at least, you have to really draw a bad opening hands, because even well, I should play first, and maybe then I can talk through the mulligan decision. Yeah, my reasoning is that if you draw a new opening seven, you of course almost guaranteed to at least also have three spells like you had in the first opening hand, because for in order for it not to be, you have to have five lands and two spells, or no lands or something like that. So I think that and all the cases in between having two lands and four spells, I think is almost always preferable to what we had there. Yeah, so I think I'm fine with mulliganing it, and the second hand also was at least as good, I think, or about as good. So, Kavu, nice tutu, and are we attacking here? I guess so. We can trade for the Kavu. Even though the Kavu doesn't do too much, but so does our Swift Spear. They are on 3 life as well, so I think. Okay, Abrupt Decay, of course. Well, we might as well activate it, but unfortunately, it doesn't prevent us from gaining life. Okay, so, but they didn't have a follow-up. That's fortunate. Is this scavenging news? Probably. So a 4 damage burn spell would be great. Three is not four, I guess. So, how many creatures are in our graveyard? So, at the moment, there is none creature in any graveyard, which means that right now they don't have an option to pump the ooze. On the other hand, they might have. They might fetch for something and play exactly Fatal Push. So the question is, what line do I go for here? Because I could go for the ooze and attack with the Swift Spear, which would result in them going down to 2 life and losing their ooze. On the other hand, if they have a Fatal Push, I think killing the ooze is the right play, but I'm worried if they have also something like invigorate or such, I'm wasting damage and might. I think I don't understand what you mean. You want to attack first, and then you want to kill the ooze, or no? So you're saying go ooze or go face? I think I don't get what exactly line your thing is correct. Every burn spell is also. We're only playing around Fatal Push here. Yeah, I think I go face, but it might be correct to go for the ooze and slow down their clock, also prevent them from getting back after there may be some other creatures in the bin. But now they can fetch. Of course they have every mana in the world between Dryad Arbor and Well, I didn't attack. I attack and then they block the Swift Spear and then I think they almost have to block. And if they block, I don't gain anything. I lose my Swift Spear and then maybe kill the ooze, at which point they are at 4 life and I lost my Swift Spear. I think I'm missing something here, or we are like talking about different things. Okay. Well, then it's always hard, especially with those special cards. Drawing the land just wasn't what the doctor ordered. Well, I'm. Okay, that's aggressive. I wonder what that is about. Do they have another sorts of plowshares? Well, I just go for it, don't I? And even sorts of plowshares only puts them up to a 4/4, to 4 life. So, is there any reason not to go for it right now? I don't think so. I guess if they have double Swords to Plowshares in hand, they could Swords to Plowshares. Well, okay, they didn't. Oof, that was very close. I'm pretty happy that we went 3-2 because after starting 2-0 and then losing the other two matches, going 2-3 would be kind of a bummer, but yeah. So also 11 people still watching. Thanks for that. And if you have any final questions, feel free to ask. I think we did fine overall. I think in the second game against Hogak, maybe we could have won and made it a series, a three-game series. If we played a little tighter and maybe shot the Root Wallers earlier, that could have been the right play, but I'm not too sure whether that's just results oriented or it was actually correct to shoot the Root Wallers. The first two matches were, I think, both pretty smoothly, nothing much to mention there. The match against Delver was close, but I think in the end it was just too many Uro and the Price of Forest showed up one turn too late. The game felt like it feels often. I think the yeah well I think the deck feels fine. But my experience over the last couple of days and the last leaks is that you really have to work hard to get your 50-50, to get your 3-2. I did a lot of 2-3ing, a little bit more 3-2ing, and a 4-1 in between, I think. So I'm net positive at like 53, 55%, I guess, in total over the last leagues. But it always feels like you have to work really hard and you have to make your opponents to make mistakes, especially in this Uro matchups and in playing against Roiling Vortex and against Exiled Firecraft. I've won a lot of games which I never was supposed to win because of some details my opponents missed whether it being the line on line of text on rolling vortex with the extra damage, or I had a spot yesterday where they would have won if they have dazed my fire blast because they knew I had an excellent firecraft in hand. I would otherwise wouldn't have been able to cast, and so on. Yeah, your experience might differ because you're also playing a much different list, right? You're playing a lot of more slanted towards Sly, so more creatures. Because right now I have the feeling against Euro, you're not very much of a favorite to win against combo decks, which are there are not too many of, luckily. You're not much of a favorite to win against some kind of janky brew, like some painter variations, or, well, Food Chain is not exactly a janky brew, but some kind of outsider, non-top tier meta decks. There you have a lot of chances, but against every meta deck, you're, or to put it that way, I don't think there is a real meta deck where with this list you're a favorite to win. That's not to say that you don't have a shot, you do, and especially if your opponents misplay a little bit, you have chances to outmaneuver them, but I think all in all, Burn is not better positioned in the meta than it was before the ban, which is funny because Astrolabe leading to less basics and banning Oko in theory should have led to a better positioning, but yeah. Deck feels fine. Also, this is just what I like to play. And also, Death in Texas feels really unwinnable right now. I don't know why it is or what changed. Because in the past, I wasn't feeling that Death in Texas was that bad of a matchup. But the last 5 or 6 times, I always got completely destroyed with sometimes winning a game. But never taking the match, and it, maybe they always have it, but I think they also just have so many things that are good enough, like Thalia, Stoneforge Mystic, Mother of Runes, all can be problematic. Sometimes even Vile and Richelieu Port really trip you up, and yeah, this is of course also comes from running a list with so many spells, and also a list with so many expensive spells. I mean, 4 Exquisite Firecraft, and 4 Prizes of Progress or Price of Progress and Vortex are of course prone to getting hit by the mana screw of Death in Texas, but yeah, so I think there are hard matchups and you can get along with Burn and go a little bit over 50-50. Yeah, so this is in a nutshell the answer, and this is also what this league has proven. We haven't played against too many meta decks. We played against Rakdelva once and kind of went 50-50 against the other decks, so yeah. Not impossible to play Burn, but if your goal is to have a high winter percentage, I would rather graviate to a Delva deck right now. Okay, so that's my monologue at the end. I hope you enjoyed the streams. Thanks for the 10 people still watching. And this will go to my YouTube channel, which is linked at my Twitch account as well. So if you missed some games, you can rewatch them there. And, well, I will probably do something like this in the near future. And, yeah, hope to see you there soon. Bye.